Please sit here, please.
I'm so happy to see this hall full of guests and hosts. And I would like to start this session of questions and answers, please.
Assalamu alaikum, sir. The first questioner is Mrs. Birun from Lucinia.
I would like to ask you two questions closely related to each other. One of them, knowing the exceptional birth of Jesus Christ, can we place him higher than other prophets? And second question, if the Christians place Jesus so high, what is, to your mind, the main reason that they completely deny him in their everyday life and behavior? Thank you very much.
I think this question should have been best answered by some Christians rather than me. Because they know the intricate reasons why they have to do it. But I can only offer a guess. The case of Jesus is a very special case. It's not that of an ordinary prophet of Allah. It is so significant in so many ways that unless you fully realize the significance of Jesus as Messiah, perhaps you cannot fully understand the attitude of Christians to him. They have definitely seen something special in him, which they did not notice or observe or read about in the Old Testament regarding other prophets. And that is why he was specifically entitled Messiah or Christ. So if every prophet shared this with him, he should have also been referred to as a Messiah and a Christ. So the important thing is that what was the significance of this title? And if the significance is correctly understood, then you can only revere such a person to the degree of his true status understood by the title. If you do not understand the significance correctly, then you may go on looking for things which were not meant by God and may imagine things about the person which did not relate to his reality. So with the case of Christians, I think this second alternative is at work. The significance of Jesus should have been understood with reference to his original reality as he appeared. And what specific task did he perform in the Judaic history, which singles him out as a, not only as a prophet, but a person holding another status or a position, or let's say, delivering a mission which was not delivered before. And that can be well understood in relation to Jesus' own attitudes, rather than what people of later ages thought about him. A few things are very clear to me. Number one, that Jesus did not change the book, nor did he ever claim to have changed the book. What he changed was attitudes. And the most significant change he brought about was attention to the shell, to change of attention from the shell to the spirit. It was the substance which he emphasized. And that was so highly needed at that time. Because the Jewish people had got stuck to the form and shell of the teachings of the Torah. So much so that they thought that if you formally subscribe to God as described literally in Torah, that is quite sufficient, and that is the, then you really attain the purpose of religion. By performing, for instance, in the case of Muslims nowadays, we see, if you just perform the prayer, but walk out of the mosque as empty as you entered, if you perform the prayer at home as well, but it does not bring about any real change in your spiritual nature and your attitude to God and attitude to His creation. This is just form. This is also a sort of idol worship. It is so close to idol worship that the Jews repeatedly committed the mistake of worshipping a God which could be presented to them visually, which had a formal existence. So this attitude, when hardened, although it hardened around the concept of unity of God, but remained a mere shell, no more. So that is against which Jesus Christ launched a great movement. And it was His emphasis on the substance and spirit of things which ultimately led St. Paul to completely misunderstand Him. While those who were directly instructed by Him under His own personal spiritual example, they disagreed with Paul and took up a cudgel for a long time for retaining the form as well as spirit and substance. So this is the struggle we find in the early history of Christianity, which answers this question partly, which you have raised, that the struggle was between form and substance, and they were taken separately, as if one would eliminate the necessity of the other. This was not Jesus. Nowhere did He do away with form. What He did was, He presented the case of a religion which had no substance left in it. This was without the love of God. And it would not serve any purpose. But the form did serve a purpose, which was to retain the spirit intact. So unfortunately, the division took place between the two extremists. One who saw Jesus as emphasizing the spirit, the others who considered Him to have abandoned the form altogether. So when they turned to spirit, then what was left of spirit? There, a new personality of Jesus began to emerge. They thought that Jesus had done away with the law so completely and totally that to live in Jesus became religion in itself. And as it had happened never before in any religious experience, so this was the special Jesus which emerged in the sight of the later day Christians. I mean, those who gradually moved away from the spirit of Jesus, that they thought He must have done away with the form, disposed of the Sharia or the law, so that man could live by his own spiritual entity in himself. And if that spiritual entity of man was at one with the spirit of Jesus, that is holiness, and that is all Jesus brought. So He stood higher above all prophets of Allah, according to them. Because by the intricate thinking of Pauline philosophy, He delivered man not from sin, but from the form of Sharia. Then sin and curse and Sharia, that is law, became synonymous to the followers of this philosophy. While the fact is that sin is born out of law, but obedience to God and love of God are also born out of the same. There is a joining point in the law which is brought by prophets, which can never be separated. And such religious philosophies which separate these two things can never survive in essence and in meaning. As Jesus, I'm talking of the general things, the result is that the bifurcation of religion leads to extremist forms and movements. Like in Islam, we notice the movement of Sufism. Sufism is almost exactly on the style of Pauline philosophy. And that also was a reaction to such extremist observers of form, who observed form meticulously, that is the mullah, who said, if you say your prayer 5 times a day, that is what Islam is, no more. If you read the Quran, whether you understand the meaning or not, doesn't make any difference. Formally pay homage to God and He is happy with you. That is all what He requires. But the Sufi understood the danger of this teaching and said that if a religion does not bring your soul closer to God, and if it is only your body which is given a sort of exercise like PT, then such a religion is not worthy of following. So they separated. But they left the farm aside exactly like St. Paul did, with the result that they started moving away into the wilderness of no law. Practically, they lived in a sort of internal experience which was so misleading in many cases. The ecstasy they felt by thinking of God internally or thinking of their saints and others whom they respected, they did get some sort of exhilaration. And that is what they thought was the living experience of religion. So in reality, if you compare the Sufism with the Pauline philosophy concerning Jesus' message, then you come to realize that this is again a universal phenomenon which occurs everywhere in the world, to every religion, only it is seldom recognized as clearly as it should be. So the image of Jesus, as stands above all the prophets of God, is born out of this misunderstanding. Jesus never broke away from the past. He never rejected even a jot of the Old Testament. When particularly confronted with this allegation, that do you reject the scriptures, he said, no. I have not come to change a jot of the book. I have come to perfect it, to fulfill it. Now this perfection is also, as I have studied, slightly mistranslated or misinterpreted. The word musaddiq is found in the Quran in exactly the same meaning. And according to the Quran, each prophet comes as a musaddiq of the previous ones and of the book, which means all the prophecies found in the books, until they are fulfilled and realized in the form of a promised reformer, they remain incomplete. So when Jesus said, I have come to complete the book, not to change a jot, it meant that the prophecies relating a revolutionary change in attitudes, which was to be brought about by the Messiah, remained incomplete until He had come. So as such, as we see from Islamic vantage point, there is no difference between Him and other human prophets except that of changing the wrong attitudes of the people of his own religion to the one which stood in balance and which always could lead to God if you kept both form and spirit of the message equally well before you and practiced both as much as you possibly could. So I think, I mean, projecting myself into the minds of others, this is what I think must have happened to them. Again, there was another dilemma which they were facing early in Christian history, which also must have unfortunately led them away from the true Jesus, the living reality of history, to a Jesus which had to be created out of the compulsion of the times. By that I mean that the fact of crucifixion has a background. It has a background in the Old Testament. Why did the Jews so much insist on Jesus hanging by the cross has its roots in a biblical prophecy whereby if a man attributes false things to God which he had not said to him, and if such a man hangs by the tree, which means by the cross, and dies upon the tree, then his being an impostor is proved beyond a shadow of doubt. This was the conspiracy against Jesus. And the Holy Quran presents the whole conspiracy relating to both the ends of Jesus' life, the beginning as well as death, or in whatever form he disappeared. According to the Holy Quran, it was a very heinous conspiracy against the person of Jesus Christ by his opponents of the time to present him to the people as a man with a false beginning, having an unchaste mother, having an illegitimate birth, and a false end, both cursed. So it were two curses which they want to relate to Jesus, which hashed this conspiracy. So the Holy Quran has summed it up in these, is this, وَقَالَهِمْ عَلَىٰ مَرْيَمَ بُهْتَانًا عَظِيمًا وَقَالَهِمْ إِنَّا قَتَلْنَا الْمَسِيحَ عِيسَى بْنَ مَرْيَمَ رُسُولُ اللَّهِ. They said, the Holy Quran says, that the crime of the Jews of his time is twofold. First, they attributed to him an illegitimate birth by claiming that his mother was not chaste. So a false beginning. Then they claimed that they had succeeded in murdering him, and later on cross is also mentioned, which means that they also claim that they murdered him through crucifixion. God denies both these charges in the Quran and presents this as reason enough for returning the curse to his opponents, the Jews, who were hurling this curse upon Jesus. So the argument presented by the Quran is that that curse fell squarely upon those who had attributed this false allegation, this curse falsely to Jesus Christ. So now, what happened at the crucifixion? What happened was that the Roman law had condemned him to death, and that Roman law is still found in operation everywhere in the world in the same spirit. That is, once a person is condemned to death by hanging or by any other means, until he dies, the decision remains hanging over his head. If the first attempt fails, another attempt will have to be made until the purpose of that condemnation is fulfilled. The threat of death would continue to hang over such a person. Now, this is what is the most important thing in this relation, in this regard, which should be kept in mind. Then I'll connect these two things with the question you raised. Now, the dilemma of the Christians was that if they claimed openly that the law and the Jews had failed to kill Jesus or murder him or condemn him to death to its end, then whenever a claimant would appear and he was dragged to the Roman court, that I have seen Jesus Christ myself alive, it would be he who would be condemned to severe punishment or even death, because he would be considered an accessory after the crime, after the fact. Why did he not capture him? Why did he not report the matter to the law? So this was a very serious crime to make such a claim. On the other hand, if they admitted that Jesus had died upon the cross, then the biblical sword would hang over their heads, informing them that this man whom you revere so much is proved to be a false person according to the criterion presented by the Bible itself. So he was an impostor, no more. This was a dilemma faced by the Christians. And those who witnessed his survival had only one option: to call it a revival instead of survival. So if you change the terminology just a little bit, instead of calling it a case of survival, if you presented it as a case of revival, then law could not touch you. Because once death was delivered, then the person is free to walk away. So this is why in the beginning this was the stance taken by his close followers and lovers, and that is why they saved their face against the Jews as well. They said, you say, if an impostor hangs by the tree, he would die, and his death would prove him to be an impostor. And you say this happened in the case of Jesus Christ, but you don't realize that he revived from the dead, which means that he was not an ordinary prophet, he was more than a prophet. So the case of a prophet was not applicable. You are judging him from the formula which is applicable only to the prophets. But if somebody revives from the dead, most certainly he stands beyond the ordinary status of prophets. Now, the word so often used in the New Testament, which was an expression of endearment only, according to me and us, that is Son of God, that helped them. They said, look here, he had to be a literal Son of God. No ordinary mortal can revive, come to life again from the dead. So you are trying to pull his leg down below the human level. But what you prove is simply this, that he was not human, all right, but beyond humans. Not a prophet, but beyond a prophet, above a prophet. And by the same juggling of the words, they proved his birth to be an additional factor as an argument in their favor. They said, now you turn to the question of birth, and now you understand it better. He did not have a known father married to Mary because he was not son of a mortal. So he must have been begotten by the conjugation, so sort of something, between God and Mary. So both these points emerge as the most important and pivotal points. Correct understanding of them is what would lead you to the correct understanding of Jesus Christ, and in no other way you can understand the fact of Jesus. So both Jews and Christians faltered on these two points. The Jews wanted to prove the point by saying he got killed on cross, so he must have been false. He was delivered by a mother without a husband, so he must have a false beginning. In answer to both these, the Holy Quran relates the words of Jesus to us, that is, what he expressed to God by way of gratitude to him, that he had blessed him in this way. And the words run, Salamun alayya, yawma wulidtu, wa yawma amutu, wa yawma ubathu hayya. They say, my birth was cursed, my death was cursed, and so I will not be raised. Peace be on me, because my birth was blessed, my death will be blessed, and it will not be through murder or killing. Amut is not an expression used for those who are murdered or killed. The word maut here applies simply to a natural death. So it was not only a prayer or an expression of gratitude, but it was also a prophecy by Jesus that my birth was clear. There's no doubt about it. But how shall you know? You can only know if the same prophecy which I'm making, or the same expression of gratitude I'm making, is proved in the latter part, in the event of death. If I escape murder, then my first claim will also be taken as true and valid. If there I'm proved wrong, then I could be taken to be wrong in both these places. So that is why the Holy Quran says he did not die upon cross. They failed to murder him. What was certain was only this fact, وَمَا قَتَلُوهُ يَقِينًا. They certainly failed to murder him. Crucifixion was just an attempt. Like murder attempts, when they fail, you can never say somebody is murdered. An attempt of murder is something else. And if crucifixion is only to the degree of an attempted murder, then it should not mean that he was crucified to the end of death. So this is how the Holy Quran resolves the issue. And a new personality of Jesus appears by the study of the Holy Quran, which is in the middle path, which leaves no room for any extreme attitude as taken by either Jews or by the Christians of today. And here lies the greatness of Jesus, the true greatness. We find him to be a very special prophet, no doubt, a prophet who stood till the end by truth and did not care what happened to him, who suffered the agonies of crucifixion, yet did not change his view and his belief and his claims. And yet he knew that he would be saved from the cross because he was a true man. He knew it because he had prayed to God to take away the bitter cup from him. And God must have promised him. Otherwise, this last cry, Eli, Eli, lema sabachthani, was out of place. Eli, Eli, lema sabachthani means that he was sure that God would fulfill his promise of saving him from this ignoble death. And there's an utter cry of not despondency, but of a sort of prayer which is so rich in meaning that it is impossible for such a prayer to be rejected. So the last we hear from Jesus is, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. It's impossible for God to have unheard this cry of anguish from a dear prophet who suffered till the end.
and stood firm in his loyalty to God. So he was saved. He was saved, and the first proof of his having been saved lies in the fact that when he was taken down from cross, his body was, an ointment was hurriedly prepared and applied to his body. While most certainly it was not the custom of the Jewish people to anoint the bodies or to apply any ointment to the body of the dead. Ointments are only applied in an attempt to either mitigate the suffering or to heal the wounds. There is no other purpose. And it served both these purposes. It mitigated the suffering as well as healed his wounds. So the Jesus we see walking out of the sepulchre is not a ghost, because it is what he himself claims. As he appears before his disciples and surprises them by his presence as a living form, because it was said he gave up his ghost. They must have heard it and taken it too seriously. So they thought he was a ghost. But Jesus said, no, I am not a ghost. So it gives lie to the impression of a viewer that he gave up the ghost. He never admitted it. He said, come here. Come and touch my wounds. Here, there, my hands. And see, I am the same person in the same body. I was crucified. And I am alive here before you. This was a 100% open and shut case of a person who had been attempted to be murdered, but his enemies failed to achieve the purpose, who almost died but did not, and survived the attempts at his life. Now, when you read this in relation to a prophecy of Jesus Christ, then the whole picture emerges as clear as day. When they demanded, some of them, of the Jewish people or other opponents, so many people belonging to different religions and beliefs, who all opposed Jesus together as a body. They were non-believers, they were people who believed in myths and ideologies other than the Jewish ideology. They always gathered around him and put him to many tests and questions. At one moment, at one occasion, when they required from him a great miracle, so they could see with their own eyes that he was from God. I don't remember the exact words, but he said, the people of this age were this and that. They demand a miracle, but no miracle will be shown unto them except the miracle of Jonah of the fish. Now, what was that miracle? Was it a case of revival, or was it a case of survival against all odds? Most certainly, there are no two opinions about this, that Jonah presented a case of survival against all odds, not a case of revival from the dead. So as I'm reconstructing the events of crucifixion and what happened following, when you remember this prophecy of Jesus Christ, then the case is cleansed. It's a very clear case of a true prophet who was true, and God had saved him. And then, after such attempts, when Allah saves His prophets and dear ones, they're always told to migrate. So did Jesus did. Now, this is the last part an integral part of the Christian beliefs by which they attempt to prove Jesus' status to be beyond all other prophets. They died natural deaths here on earth, but he disappeared into heaven, bodily, Why the necessity of such a belief? There's some reasons and valid reasons for that. First of all, if they claimed that he had not died, or he had died and again became alive after death, then that first question which would be, first demand which would be made upon them would be, ask him to appear before us then. If he did not die, then his body has become eternal, immortal, whatever form it is. Because once somebody survives death or revives from survives death, comes to life again, then he can't be killed again, by no means. So the first logical question which should have been addressed to them and they were confronted with was, all right, let Jesus appear before us. So he did not appear. The second, if not, where has he gone? Where is his body? Why has he disappeared altogether? Is he hiding? And if he's hiding, why don't you produce him? Or the law will deal with you if you're hiding the body of a criminal, dead or alive, he must be presented to prove that he ultimately got killed according to the purpose of the law. But these two demands could not be met by them. So this concept of ascension to heaven was born naturally out of this dilemma. Now previously, some Christian scholars used to quote Mark, I think it was Mark, where in the last 12 verses it was said that Jesus ascended to the heaven. But now all the Christian scholars have agreed unanimously that these 12 verses where this is mentioned are false. They are not found in the original text at all. They were added later on. So there is no single proof of Jesus' ascension. But some excuse had to be discovered, had to be invented to prove that he lived. But why is he not visible? Because he has gone somewhere. So they did not want to disclose the identity of his migration. So they said he had ascended to heaven to further prove the point that he was not immortal, but he was literally the Son of God. This is the dilemma of Christianity which helped St. Paul to legendize the fact of crucifixion and to mythify the noble reality of Jesus Christ. And because Roman Empire was already a most fertile recipient soil for such philosophies, because they themselves had believed in Trinity before. They themselves had believed for centuries in mythologies and God, humans taking forms of God, descending from heaven or ascending to heaven, but humans taking forms of God, or God taking form of humans. So this was no alien philosophy to them. And that is why they accepted it in large numbers. And it was there that St. Paul struck the bonanza for Christianity. So these, I feel, are the reasons why the Christians have to believe in this mythified form of Jesus Christ, while I believe it would be far greater loyalty to Jesus if they stuck to his reality, which is far more noble. Myths are not noble. They're imaginary things. With powers, myths live with powers which are not shared by human beings. So what are we to them? What are they to us? But a person being a human being, being immortal, reaches such heights of great sacrifice and perfect example as Jesus did, that is the noble image which is worthy of all love. So we are not an opponent of Christianity. We are the true lover of Jesus Christ, and we invite Christians to look at that great hero in religious history from our eyes and revere him the more and love him the more, not at the cost of unity of God, but in perfect agreement with the unity of God. Have I answered your question? Thank you.
We invite Mr. Keith Wakely from Wimbledon. He has two questions, please.
Thank you. The Bible tells us, "Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God." What is your interpretation of the pure in heart? And the second one, I read in the Times about 2 weeks ago that a charity was buying slaves' freedom in Sudan, and if I may just read the first paragraph, a British charity working in Sudan is buying back Christian slaves kidnapped by Arab militias and forced to become Muslims.
They are being forced to become Muslims?
Yes.
By whom?
By the Arab militias.
So I do not subscribe to that and forced conversion. This is why we are made subject of persecution by the mainstream Muslims. We do not subscribe to such views because we consider such views as absolutely against Islamic teachings and against the fundamental teachings of Islam, particularly.
Yes. I rather felt that you would answer like that.
Yes.
But are there any other forms of slavery in Islam?
But we'll come to that question in full later on. First, with the first question.
Yes.
The first question was perhaps, what is the meaning of the purity of heart?
Purity of heart.
You see, the purity of heart is not a religious term belonging to a certain religion of a certain place or a certain area or time. Purity of heart has always been the subject and the most essential subject of discussion of all such faiths which term themselves as religions, even those who do not believe in God or apparently do not believe in God, like Buddhists, like Jainists and some others, who have gone away from, like the philosophies of Taoism, etc. They're also referred to as godless philosophies, although I disagree with that, that's a different thing altogether. What I mean to say is, as they present religion, the central point is always purification of heart. How can you meet this end? By what means? It is there that the religious teachings differ. Those who believe in God, they also believe that without your coming into some sort of communion with God, purification of heart cannot be achieved. To live with God, to live in God, means that you follow His attributes, such attributes which are within the human capacity to follow and acquire. So this also explains the meaning of man having been created after the nature of God. God has created man ultimately to become good. If the basic fundamental design of man was not good, it would not have been possible for man ever to become good. So the purity of heart is to return to the original design. That is why even those religions who do not believe in God, they somehow acquire this. What they have to do is, they have to delve deeper into their own nature. And they reach the same ultimate end of discovering an innate goodness in all human beings. So they say, we have discovered the secret from within us. The religion says, no, in that exercise you may even be misled by your own views and thoughts and cultural influences and the influences of the age, and you may think that you have reached the truth, but it has to be verified from an outer truth, by an outer truth. Without that, there cannot be a certainty regarding your having reached the source of truth or purification. In this regard, Islam has a very clear attitude and very logical and sensible attitude. In fact, you can't do away with it in any form. You have to agree because it's so logical. The founder of Ahmadiyya community, Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam, has written volumes on this subject, purity of heart. And he has likened it to all human faculties which are all of them dependent on an outer reality which correlates with them. For instance, if the eyes are good and the sight is perfect and healthy, if there is no sun shining, no light coming from the heaven, they can't see. So inner truth is only to the extent of your being capable of receiving the outer truth. The ears can be absolutely healthy and perfect, yet if there is no vibration in the air, no sound, they won't hear anything. Taste, of course we can taste things if we are healthy, but there must be something to create the taste. Empty mouth and empty stomach cannot taste anything. So this is the explanation put forward by Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam, the founder of the Ahmadiyya community, in relation to inner truth and outer truth and their interrelationship. So the purity of heart is the sum total of these five senses, where they ultimately converge and ultimately create one single entity. If all the five senses are pure and healthy, and if they are in communion with the outer sources which are corresponding to them, then the heart is purified, without a shadow of doubt. Without it, it may be on way to purification. It may be innocent. But perfect purification, a purposeful purification, cannot be achieved without the meeting together of inner truth and outer truth. That is what we understand by these terms, and I hope this would also be acceptable to many. Thank you. The second question was relating to
slavery and what forms of slavery does Islam have.
You see, Islam, as I have many times before explained, is misunderstood in many regards also in respect of slavery. The Holy Prophet once said, how can you make a person slave whom God had given birth, whom God had created as a free person? So this is a very important declaration. No man has a right to enslave a person born free. But the matters do not end here. If you have inherited a system of slavery where others had enslaved people, rightfully or wrongfully, and where the society had accepted a form of transfer of this slavery through exchange of commodities or money, etc., then what should be the attitude? That is the second question. Islam did not do away with the inherited institution of slavery with one declaration that free all your slaves, because that would have done greater damage to the society if it was attempted in one single stroke. It's all the economy of the period was so interwoven with the system of slavery of that time that it would, in the name of goodness, it may ultimately end up in some evil rather than goodness. And what would those slaves do? How would they survive? Who would take care of them? They had no right to be equally treated according to the society around. They would immediately be recaptured by the non-Muslims living around, because as such they had no right to live freely. There were many possible dangers to the slaves themselves, which must have ultimately resulted in this teaching from Allah, that if you do not enslave people without your right to enslave them, this is right. But you must also begin to liberate slaves. And herein is the Quranic teaching, which is incomparable with any other teaching in the world. The ways and means suggested in the Quran and enforced many a time, by which slaves could be liberated, are so many that it is impossible for these means to be taken seriously and for the society to implement them, and yet slavery to survive within a few generations. It must come to an end. For very small crimes, mistakes, follies, this and that, omissions, the remedy suggested by the Quran is free a slave, liberate a slave. And then the Holy Quran says that the best people in the sight of Allah are those who liberate slaves. So this resulted in a mass movement among the Muslims for the liberation of slaves. And when there was no other means legally to turn the free people into slaves, then automatically slavery must have come to an end. Why it did not was because in many other cases the Muslims of the following generation did not practice Islam. They ignored Islamic injunctions wherever it suited them. And this happens with every society, so the fault lies not with the Quranic teachings, but with those people who took the teaching lightly or misunderstood the teaching. Now, in this regard, I must also point out that the teachings regarding slaves also must be understood according to the Quranic injunctions and the ahadith, that is the traditions or instructions of Hazrat Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam himself and his practice. According to Islamic injunctions, the picture which emerges is that if you have a slave, you must treat him with honor, with equality. You must feed him with the food with which you feed your own family. You must dress them in a manner that you dress your own family members. You must not speak harsh words to them. If you strike them, you may earn the wrath of Allah. And the only remedy for this, if you have done it, being carried away by your sentiments or anger, is to liberate the slave. Now, this was done so repeatedly and consistently by Hazrat Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam that there are many an example where a slave committed a mistake and somebody lost his temper and struck him. And once it happened many times, but once it so happened that Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam himself was coming in the direction of the person who was striking his slave. Not viciously to the degree that he could have broken his legs or things, but he struck at him. And Hazrat Muhammad shouted, he didn't shout normally, but raised his voice and said, "Abu Masood, Abu Masood, oh, what is happening?" He understood the tone of urgency and displeasure, and he turned and he paled at seeing his impression. He said, "O Prophet of Allah, I liberate this slave immediately now." He said, "Had you not done this, you had earned hell. So the attitude towards slaves is also so important that the slavery does not become as heinous to look at if the slavery is practiced in the short term that it is practiced, should be practiced in Islam, on the according to the instructions of the Holy Quran. And the love that was generated because of this teaching between slave and the master was so intense sometimes that given the opportunity of liberation, the slaves themselves would reject to benefit from that. It particularly happened in the case of Hazrat Muhammad Rasulullah Sallam's own slave, Zaid. His parents were some nobles from perhaps Persia or some other country who had lost their son, and they didn't know much about him, where he had gone and disappeared. When the fame of Islam spread far and wide, they heard the name of their own son mentioned in relation to the Holy Prophet. So they ultimately approached him and said, "You claim to be the Prophet of Allah. We have come here not to accept Islam, but to claim what belongs to us, our son." He said, "Yes, he's yours for the taking. No problem." He called Zaid and said, "Here are your parents, and I, with all my heart, I permit you, without any reservation, to go with them and return to your home and your own land." He looked up at him and said, "O Prophet of Allah, not after I have known you. It's impossible." Turned to his parents and said, "I know your parents, I respect and love you, but I love him more." So it was the slavery of love which had been transformed from the slavery of a cruel form against which no human can really take an exception. So if you read the true teachings of the Holy Quran regarding slavery, then it does not appear to be such a heinous thing as normally it is related to. Now, things have changed, I know. There is still slavery practiced in Saudi Arabia and some other Muslim countries, most unfortunately, because they exploit the poverty of some poor nations. And they think, which we consider absolutely wrong, that if they go to India, to Madras, some other backward countries of parts of India, where even the parents of a poor child are compelled to sell that child for the sake of economic necessity. At least, if not for their own sake, for the sake of the child itself, because they know he would be better fed outside and better clad outside. So they sell and they buy them. But the interesting thing is that except for a few cases in Sheikhdom, most often in Saudi Arabia, the slaves are treated with such equality that those Ahmadis which have been there, which have been moving in and out of the palaces of the princes, they have borne witness to me that we have seen the slaves to be clad like them, to be sitting on the same sofas, sharing the same style of life, so much that sometimes it was very difficult for us to find which was the master and which was the slave. Bad as it may be, but not as bad as slavery has been practiced elsewhere in the world. Particularly, as I've mentioned, the earlier periods of slavery, forced enslavement of people of Africa, and the torture they suffered. And despite the fact that there is no slavery in America, no legality in slavery, yet the blacks are treated even worse than slaves. Somehow, very cleverly, you know, they're kept at a third or fourth rate level, and they're rotting in slums, and there's no hope for their rise to the equal level with the whites. This is unwritten slavery, but much more heinous than the slavery practiced in Saudi Arabia, for instance. Because a whole people have lost the purpose, direction, the end product of their life. And that is why, you know, with people like Farrakhan and so on, they are capable of gathering even 1 million people by way of protest. They're misled, I know. When I go there, I meet the leadership and I tell them, this is no way of liberating yourself. The best way is to liberate yourself from the evils and ills of the society. Liberate yourself from the crime. Then none could keep you suppressed, because there is no legal instrument here by which you could be suppressed if you benefit from the options and possibilities of such gateways as are open to all, provided you behave well, provided you offer sacrifices, provided you get education and emphasize the role of morality. Then no society on earth can keep you suppressed. This is my message against the message of Farrakhan. But unfortunately, people want excitement and want cheap and shortcuts to success. And there is no cheap and shortcut to success. So this is all I could say here at this moment, please. I know your deep interest, your dedication to the purpose of liberating slaves and doing away with the slavery, whether it is apparent or subdued. Am I right? Thank you. Thank you.
We now invite Mrs. Sheila Yasmin from Wimbledon.
Yes.
Mrs. Sheila Yasmin, please.
Sheila Yasmin, how are you?
Very well, thank you. Yes.
Now, what does this name indicate? Sheila Yasmin.
Sheila Yasmin.
I see. So, Yasmin. He read it as Yasmin, which looks like, sounds like a Muslim name.
Yes. Yes.
Is it a Muslim name?
Yes.
Okay. Yes. Okay.
Her husband is a Muslim.
We Christians believe in the second advent of Jesus, son of Mary. I understand that Muslims also believe in the second advent of Jesus, son of Mary.
Right.
How do you explain that Mirza Ghulam Ahmed, whom you believe to be the promised Messiah, when he is not Jesus, son of Mary?
I can explain in the terms of the understanding of the divine word by Jesus, son of Mary himself. He should be the last authority, last word on this issue. When it was demanded from him to produce Elijah or Elijah, the prophet of God who had ascended to heaven, sitting on his fiery chariot, to have come again before the coming of Christ. What was the answer? He pointed at John the Baptist, not pointing his finger directly at his body, he was not there, but pointing at him in meaning. He said, he is the Elijah. Now, not Elijah, but the Elijah, which you are expecting. Believe it or not, it's up to you. So he was not named Elijah. His name was John. He was son of Zechariah, not born of the same parents as Elijah of old was born. All names differed. The prophecy apparently, and in fact rather very clearly depicted, of the physical bodily reappearance of Elijah from the heaven. So how would you rate the decision of Jesus Christ in this regard? Will he be taken to be right in declaring that John the Baptist, despite no commonality between him and the earlier Elijah, was right when he passed this judgment. If you say, yes, he was right, then by the same judgment, Mirza Ghulam Ahmed of Qadian is proved to be right. Because then the meaning is that the re-coming of such people who have a definite parenthood, definite name, definite occupation in time or history, when they are promised to come again, they never come again bodily. They always come in the form of, in spirit, in character, in teaching, in style. So if Mirza Ghulam Ahmed of Qadian is taken to be wrong in declaring him to be the son of Mary in this meaning, in this understanding of the term, then you have to reject not one Messiah but both the Messiahs, unfortunately. Either you keep both or reject both, because the verdict is passed and it would not permit you to separate between one Messiah and the other. So these are metaphorical expressions. Prophecies are made with reference to specific, particular persons. And they are not made only in Judaic religion or in Islam alone. They have been made all over the world. But literally, they have not got fulfilled even once in the entire history of mankind. Metaphorically, yes. All the prophecies have been fulfilled. So you have to judge the claim of Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmed in line with the claim of all such people appearing everywhere in the world in the name of the earlier holy people who had claimed to reappear. So we don't believe he was a reincarnation, not at all. What we believe is that he relived Jesus in Islam by changing the attitudes which he changed earlier, by presenting an example like the example of Jesus Christ himself. What he had done, he had changed attitudes, as I earlier said. Instead of emphasis on sword and forceful coercions, as you indicated just now, the emphasis was on sacrifice. If somebody strikes you on one cheek, offer the other one. Now, this is also a biblical teaching. The window of forgiveness was kept open, but practically kept shut by the people. So he practically shut the window of vengeance and revenge and widened this window of forgiveness to the degree. He said, all right, if somebody strikes you, be patient, be perseverant. Somebody abuses you, don't call him bad names, pray for him. So this is how he was Jesus, son of Mary, in spirit and in attitudes. Thank you.
Hazur, we now invite Mr. Tim K. from Brecknell. Mr. Tim K., please.
Mr. Tin K from Brighton. Right.
Hello, sir.
You have come all the way from Brighton for this purpose?
No, Bracknell.
Oh, sure, right. Right.
I would like to ask.
Please raise the microphone or lower your.
Oh yeah, of course.
yourself. Thank you.
I would like to ask, there's a lot of suffering in the world, of course. Will there ever be a time when people of different religions, different religious leaders, ever come together? And has this Messiah that you believe in, has he made any prophecies about the coming together of religions?
Well, prophecies are found all over the world of unification of man under one religion. But never have I found any prophecy anywhere of amalgamation of religions into one. They're two different things. They can never happen. Unity is reborn.
Yes.
And it gains mass as it rolls on. But unity cannot be forged by combining different forces, different ideologies, and amalgamating into one and presenting them under one flag. That's not unity. So the claim of all religions, as I understand, when they speak of a golden age, when man will become united under one flag, only means that a movement will be launched, a divine movement in the latter days, whereby gradually, by changing our ideologies, by changing our thoughts and attitudes, a new entity would begin to arise and gather force and gather mass until it becomes largest, and it will not be based on any racial or geographical philosophy. It will be based entirely on universal philosophy. So people from all over the world would come and join and feel at one with each other, sharing the same equality. That is how we feel that we, inshallah, are going to bring about the unity of man under the flag of Islam as we understand that. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
We now invite Mr. Javed Tanveer from High Wycombe, please.
Hi Wycombe. Originally, if you are from the Punjab?
Yes, from Lahore.
Lahore?
Yes.
Right. From walled city or from the outer Lahore?
In Kent, cantonment.
So that means you must have migrated from East Punjab and settled there. Could have been, I mean, not must.
No, sir.
No? You're originally Lahori?
I'm originally.
Or from some other district?
No, I belong to NWFP.
NWFP?
Yes.
Oh, so that's what I understand. The Lahoris, true Lahoris are those who are born in the walled city.
Yeah.
And their style is very specific and recognizable. Others are either immigrants or coming from different provinces and places. Right, yes. Okay. Thank you. Please.
Sir, my question relates to the same subject as discussed earlier about the ascension of Jesus Christ, how real it is.
The features or similarities, is that what you mean?
Yeah.
How we can present some similarities between the Messiah we believe in as the re-advent of Jesus and the first Jesus, whose image he claims to be, correct?
Yes.
Right. So, it's a long list. All of you have to be patient with me, but I won't exhaust it. I'll just present to you a few cases by way of demonstration. You are a Muslim, of course. You should also bear in mind that the Holy Quran speaks of a similarity between Moses and Muhammad Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam as well. Does it not? And so, there is a prophecy of Hazrat Moses himself in Deuteronomy chapter 22, isn't it? 18, chapter 18, verse 18. Chapter 18, verse 18. That a prophet would be raised from among your brethren, like unto you. That is these similar words. So what are the similarities between Moses and Hazrat Muhammad Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam? First of all, that question has to be answered. Second, Hazrat Muhammad Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was prophesied in the New Testament as well by Jesus Christ. And there his description is different from that of Moses. So that means a Messiah was also to be born in Islam. And that is why Hazrat Muhammad Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam repeatedly prophesied that in my ummah also, in the latter days, in the end days, a Messiah will be born. So, relating both these issues, you will come to a better understanding of similarities. The similarity between Moses and Hazrat Muhammad Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, first of all, was that both brought a new law. And a fiery law, you know, a sort of glow with glory and majesty. And that law got enforced with complete success within their lifetimes. and they did not leave the world until they had seen the law established and enforced. Secondly, this requires a rapid movement, which was also related with the use of force and sword whenever sword was raised against them. Both Moses was permitted and Hazrat Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and peace be upon Moses as well. So this is another similarity which we see. And after that, the enforcement of law takes place many centuries. The real, not only enforcement of law, I mean, talking from the political point of view, I don't mean that, but sinking of the law into the people and their habits takes a very long time. And in the first beginning of the Islamic movement, it began to spread, not by sword, as people believe, but by the deliverance of message and deliverance of the Quranic values as practiced by the Muslims of the time. This is important for me to emphasize, because there are many non-Muslims present here who misunderstand the spread of Islam to have been depended upon the use of sword. You see, the largest population of the Muslims are found in Indonesia, in Malaysia, in four provinces of China. And the history tells us that not a single battle was fought for the sake of Islam in all these countries. Yet it spread. And it spread faster and wider. Where the Muslims ruled for many centuries continuously in India, the progress of Islam was much slower, and with obstruction here and there, it spread, but it remained to be a minority for the last 1,000 or more years. So that is what should be kept in mind. So the first message was given a push off with a great impetus and a great force, until it reached its climax in having delivered the message of Islam and having established it to all the important known countries of the world of that time, except a portion which is called the West. There it only stuck at the walls and knocked at the walls and made an entry and quickly withdrew, but didn't leave a lasting impression on the people, except for a few exceptions like Bosnia and things. Now I come to the period which had to follow. During this course, politics began to be intermingled with Islamic ideology when the spread of Islam also resulted in Muslim states. They came to be born. And whenever state interplays with religious hierarchy, havoc is played both to the politics and to religion. That is exactly what happened during the medieval centuries. And they distorted the image of Islam to that of a national movement, of a racial movement, of a territorial movement. So the term holy war or jihad came to be misunderstood as a movement of subjugation of all the people of the world, politically and ideologically, with the help of your thumb on the throats. Now how they understand it to have happened, I can't understand. It's impossible for the soul to change the ideas, beliefs. They can sever the heads from the body, but they cannot change a single belief of the head of the mind within the head. They can create reactions, of course. Subjugation only takes place when something within the people, such people who are coerced, something of life and honor within them have already died. When they are neither fit as Christians or as Muslims or anything else, as long as that honor lives, they would not bow to sword. So the sword seems to be successful in some phases of history, but to no purpose. Names were changed, styles were changed, but the hearts remained as atheistical, as atheist-minded, and attitudes were as corrupt as they used to be before. So, leaving that aside, now I turn to the last recipe for such a situation. When the hearts are hardened, when the message is understood to be that of a forceful change in the ideology of the world and the forceful imposition of the Muslim states upon the non-Muslim states. Is that not exactly the attitude found in the time of Jesus Christ among the Jews? This was the fight about. This was all the difference between the Christians, between Christ and the Jews. You know, they demanded that we were expecting a Christ, but a Christ with a throne under him and a crown over his head. A Christ would leave the movement of rebellion against the Roman yoke. And you have come to perpetuate our slavery? And this is what you call the spirit of Christ? We reject it. It's meaningless. But Christ said, all right, go ahead what you do, but you will suffer. And that is what they did. They went on making rebellions, fighting others in the name of religion, and they were thoroughly demolished and defeated by a general of the Romans in 71 or 72 after Christ. But Christianity, which did not have any sword in its hand, went on flourishing and spreading despite all opposition. Here the sword was taken from the hands of the believers and handed over entirely to the hands of the oppressors and rejectors. Yet it spread. So it was Jesus Christ and his movement which gave, a measure of honor to the early success of Judaism. If Jesus had not appeared, then all were justified in concluding that the message of Moses and the teachings of Torah has no inherent beauty in it. It is only when it ran along with force and coercion that it acquired a measure of success, otherwise in itself it's mere ugliness. But what Jesus did was a revolution in this area, brought about a revolution. He said, all right, I stick to the same values. You take the sword in your hand. You try to destroy me and my followers and crush them. Do whatever you may. We are going to emerge victorious. It was this belief of Jesus in truth itself which brought about the great revolution in the ideologies and the attitudes of the people around. So first of all, Hazrat Mirza Sahib should be understood in this context. Is it not exactly the same battle which began between him and the Orthodox Muslims? They wanted a liberator from the British yoke who would raise sword against them and lead them to victory. No such Messiah came to them and said, all right, we do not believe in a slave Messiah. That is how he was ridiculed even by Iqbal. He said, we do not believe in those who are slaves to be honored as prophets of Allah. Those who live under a foreign yoke, they are not worthy of acceptance as the messengers of God. This is exactly the allegation against Jesus Christ which was leveled by the Jews. Now, Iqbal, I don't know why he chose to forget the status of Joseph, son of Jacob, who he believed to be a prophet of God, but he lived all his life under a foreign yoke. He accepted a high office under a king who did not believe in him. So to live under a foreign yoke does not result in giving right to the people to reject such a man. So he should have, Iqbal should have started his journey with Joseph first, then he should have come to Jesus Christ himself and said, there goes another claimant, a slave prophet. Unless Masih Maud al-Islam had that something in common with Jesus, he could not have been taken as seriously as a true image of Jesus and repetition of Jesus' message. But that's not all. What happened then, from then on, Jesus and his followers were put through the mill of persecution so severely and so cruelly, and they were declared to be outside the pale of Judaism. They were declared to have no right to live unless they defiled the teachings of Christ and the image of Christ, or unless they abused him and cursed him. The history is full of such events. And it is being repeated here now in Pakistan, from where you have come. They catch hold of Ahmadis, poor Ahmadis, and say, abuse Mirza Ghulam Ahmed, or we will not leave you alone. Or either sometimes they are killed because they refuse to abuse, or they are beaten up and left as pulp. Sometimes imprisoned under false allegations that we have done it because such a man was insulting Nauz Billah Min Zalik Hazrat Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. A man who is so honorable, as offers every sacrifice but does not succumb to the pressure of the sword or force, how could he tell falsehood, who speak falsehood, utter falsehood? He's honest and true. Otherwise he will not offer sacrifices for the sake of his own beliefs. So when he says, I love Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, I believe in him, I know that Mirza Ghulam Ahmed of Qadian received all honors from him, and he was his ultimate master, they have no right to reject this belief. But it goes on. So this is again a repetition of the early history. The attitudes were changed, and the people of followers of Jesus Christ were persecuted for their noble attitudes, not for crimes. This is exactly being repeated in case of the followers of Hazrat Mirza Sahib. They are not beaten up for stealing. They are not beaten up for usurping others' rights. They are not beaten up for appearing in the court for false witnessing, etc., etc. They are not beaten up for drugs. They are beaten up for, and in Northwest Province, I'm telling you, they are beaten up and prosecuted and condemned to serve imprisonment for 3 years to begin with, then it was reduced to 1 year. You know for what crime? Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim was discovered from the house of this man as police raided his house for illicit things. The first report of the police, which was taken seriously and accepted by the judge, was that the crime of this man was that when we raided his house and searched him and his possessions, we discovered Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, which means in the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful, oft repeating his mercy. So if such are the crimes of Ahmadis today, go back to the time of Jesus, similar were the crimes of the people there. They didn't rob anybody. They didn't kill anybody. They didn't usurp anybody's rights. They didn't indulge in child abuse or abduction and asking for money and blackmailing and all this. All this is left to the lot of the mullahs in Pakistan and their followers. They appropriate these rights. But Ahmadis, they are not given the right to declare La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. For that,
the death penalties are hanging over their heads today. Is it not like the movement of Jesus Christ? But that is not enough. Many a time a minority is persecuted and destroyed if God is not at the back. But it did not happen in case of Jesus Christ and his followers. They tried to pulverize Christianity to smithereens, to smallest pieces. But every time they passed out of the mill of persecution, they were larger and bigger and stronger. Is that not what is happening to Ahmadiyya? So what other signs do you require? And then the time measure, the difference between Moses and Jesus is 1300 years. The difference between Hazrat Muhammad Rasulullah and Mirza Ghulam Ahmed of Qadian claimant to Messiahhood is 1300 years. Jesus did not bring a new law. He claimed that he has not come to change a single jot of the Quranic teaching or the word of Muhammad Rasulullah. So are there not similarities enough for one to seriously contemplate the possibility of becoming an Ahmadi? Thank you.
There is a question from the lady side. Her name is Mrs. Habibur Rahman Tuti. She is brought by Mr. Mansoor,
yes,
of Tooting.
Right.
The question is, could you please throw some light on the divine authenticity of Bible and Quran and their preservation?
See, the divine authenticity of the books can best be judged by two measures, according to me. First, the quality of the teaching. The divine teachings have in themselves a quality of goodness which defends the claimant and his innocence. Because if somebody was from Satan, or somebody, if somebody stood more for because of some internal motivations of his own interest, then his teachings must be corrupt by that degree. If the teaching is honest and straightforward, then such a teaching cannot be rejected as false. So that is why the Holy Quran repeatedly points out at the commonality of all religious teachings. The Holy Quran says, this is how you should judge a book, a divine book, whether it is from God or not, that basically, essentially, it has exactly the same teaching as other religions have taught before. And a false man would not require, he has no reason to begin to support truth for the sake of some ulterior motives. All false people who claim to be from God and were destroyed and were turned into things of history was those who invented teachings which had crookedness about them. They resulted in some gains for him and his supporters. Mostly they came always with the support of a group or a clan. Never will you find a man rising alone without any support and attributing a teaching to God which was absolutely plain, simple, honest, and based on goodness and wisdom and reason. So one way of judging comparing the Quran and the Bible, and not only them but other divine books, is to go for the essence of the teaching. Is it essentially good or bad? Secondly, you should compare it with nature as created by God. If unnatural claims are made, then that teaching has to be rejected in as much as the unnatural claims are made. But this presents a dilemma. If unnatural claims are made in any divine book or supposedly divine book, then there are only two possibilities of settling the issue. Either that such unnatural teachings were added by man, they were interpolated by man, of an age where he did not understand the phenomena of nature, but attributed things to the teaching to maybe to attack people through another means, because at that time some false claims about how the nature works could attract people to the so-called truth of the religion. For instance, it is emphasized about Jesus Christ that because he was born here on earth, so the sun and the planets moved around the earth and earth remained stationary, and it was disrespectful of anybody to believe that earth went round the sun. Now that part, latter part, came to be born later on, but in the beginning it was a united, accepted belief among the Christians, based according to their understanding of scriptures, of course, that earth was stationary, and it had to be stationary, because it will be disrespectful of Jesus Christ to have born in a place which in itself was revolving around other things. So Galileo paid the price, or nearly paid the price of declaring that earth went round sun and other planets also revolved round it. But he was not brave enough, unless, in fact, his admission to the church that I withdraw my claim is a blemish on the community of scientists. He didn't change his mind, but he saved his skin and lost his honor in science. But that is an example. When you study Bible critically, then you realize that this was never claimed by God himself. Whatever has been claimed was either misinterpreted or interpolated with by the people of that age with a wrong understanding of the universe around them. So this second criterion is also very important. According to the Holy Quran, Bible was the word of God, but with the condition that that word of God was changed by the people and the scribes themselves. So wherever there is a contradiction, it's not the contradiction between one word of God and the other word of God, it is because of this discrepancy created by human beings. So this is a very large subject, and I know the time is coming to a close. Where is the... That's right, it's right over there. Only 6 minutes are left. I think it will give you a general idea of what we believe about the truth and how we believe about the truth of the Old Testament, the New Testament and the Quran, despite of the fact of apparent contradictions between them.
We invite now Mr. Habibur Rahman Talukdar from Tooting. Please.
Huh?
Mr. Habibur Rahman Talukdar.
Right, please.
Well, this is what's a simple question. Does Islam encourage scientific experimentation and development? This is the first one. Second one is there any mention of atomic energy in the Holy Quran?
Yes. Yes. You see, Islam, in fact, not only Islam, but no religion on earth who is true in its beginning can contradict the act of God which is expressed in the way he has created. This contradiction in terms cannot be accepted. So we believe that, and we, with the grace of Allah, we can prove it, that all religions at their beginning were exactly in conformity with the nature created by God. And we do not only defend the Holy Quran in this regard, but also the Bible. We tell the Christians and the Jews, please don't take these things literally. read them in the light of what the Quran has spoken on the same subject, and then you will begin to understand the true import of those verses of the Bible which seem to be contradicting nature. So the Holy Quran repeatedly demands people to use their brains, their heads, their aqal. أَفَلَا تَعْقِلُونَ أَفَلَا تَعْقِلُونَ. He said, why don't these people use wisdom which God has given them? Or are there locks on their hearts? So the one religion which emphasizes the role of wisdom and understanding is unfortunately treated by the so-called custodians of that religion as not permitting the use of wisdom with relation to the Quran and the relation to Islam. This is their falsehood, not the falsehood of the Quran. Now the second question was of the same nature, but specifically you inquired about atomic energy. Okay, I understand.
Sir, is there any mention of atomic energy in the Holy Quran?
There is a definite mention of the atomic energy, and also of the atomic explosion, also the consequences thereof, and the extremely dangerous radiating cloud spreading over the world and destroying life within, underneath. All these things are mentioned in the Holy Quran very clearly. To begin with, I quote a surah of the Holy Quran, a small surah at the end of the chapter, in the last chapter, in the last part, what do you call it? Last part, that is 30th part. And I refer to Surah Humaza. It says, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ويل لكل همزة لمزة الذي جمع مالا وعددا يحسب أن ماله أخلدا كلا لينبذن في الحطمة وما أدراك ما الحطمة نار الله الموقدة التي تطلع على الأفئدة إنها عليهم موصلة في أمد ممددة. Now, leaving the first part for a while because of the shortage of time, I come to the crux of the matter. It says such and such people as have been described will be thrown into the smallest particle. What sense does it read? لَيُمْبَذَنَّ فِي الْحُتَمَةِ. And consult all Arabic dictionaries, hutama is like the particle which does not, which one cannot see with unaided eye, or with the unaided eye only when it passes through a beam of light. Then you begin to see very small minute particles floating in the air, not otherwise. I don't see any particle, but sometimes if a beam is thrown, then you see, begin to see many small tiny particles hanging in the area where the beam is striking. So it's amazing, but it's not enough. That's not all. لَيُمْبَذَنَّ فِي الْحُتَمَةِ. And the next question which is raised is fantastic. وَمَا أَدْرَاكَ مَا الْحُتَمَةِ. How on earth can we make you understand what hutama is? Because time had not yet come for the people to understand. Time was yet to come for people to know what atom was and what it could do. It says, وَمَا أَدْرَاكَ مَا الْحُطَمَةُ نَارُ اللَّهِ الْمُوْقَدَةُ الَّتِي. We are talking of the fire of God which will be built. مُوْقَدَةُ الَّتِي, it will be built within this small particle. تَتَّلَيُوا عَلَى الْأَفْهِدَةِ. A strange fire it would be. Before burning the bodies, it will leap directly at the hearts and make them cease to beat. تَتَّلَيُوا عَلَى الْأَفْهِدَةِ. إِنَّهَا عَلَيْهِمْ مُوْصَدَةٌ. This fire within that hutama is closed or locked up for them in what form? In fi amadim mumaddada. Amad is like a pillar, but mumaddada means which is made to look like a pillar after stretching it. Now, if you ever happen to see the picture of atom or the substance, radioactive substance which is about to explode, you will see without fail the scientist presenting it in the form of something which is extended to the sides and extended beyond its original size in the form of a pillar like being extended until it breaks and explodes. So what better description of atom and atomic bomb could you expect from any book at a time when the concept of atom was not yet born? That is why I searched far and wide for an explanation from earlier commentators regarding this. I found none. They were completely perplexed. All that they could offer was, maybe this pillar is the name of a pillar in hell. Hell, of course it would be. But not in the hereafter here, in this world. Then the Holy Quran speaks of Qariya, a terrorizing sound which will destroy everything by the immense intensity of the wave. But returning to this verse, have you ever seen a fire which does not burn first but leaps at the heart directly without heat wave touching the body? If you have not, read the history of Hiroshima, written by a scientist. They would tell you that the atomic explosion released shock waves, and as a shock waves as well as heat waves. But the shock waves traveled faster than the heat waves, and all other forms of radiation were left behind. And it was the shock waves which killed people, because immediately the hearts were arrested under that immense shock. Like the microwave, if somebody is subjected to a microwave, his heart would come to a standstill immediately. So the Holy Quran goes to the length of describing the nature of that fire locked within the heart of an unseen, invisible small particle, in the form that when it explodes, it leaps at the hearts and destroys them. But the consequences of this atomic explosion are further explained in Surah Ad-Dukhan, which means the smoke. And it is said that a day would come when a smoke would begin to travel, move along the earth and countries, which will spell death and destruction. And no body will be able to escape from its destruction on whom this smoke shadows, casts a shadow. Now you read the description and you have to admit that before the discovery of atomic radiation spreading through cloud and smokes, spelling destruction on whatever they cast their shadows, was seen, witnessed by you yourself today, unless you had done it, you couldn't understand it. So the Holy Quran is not a book of the past. It is a living book. It specifically mentioned all the important events and inventions by man of this age, even speaking of the attempt to change nature of God through tempering with the genes and characters, etc. Even that is mentioned. Enough? Thank you. Thank you.
Next question is the last one, and that is, we invite Mr. Ghazali from Sierra Leone, please.
From Sierra Leone.
Yes, please. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah.
People are going to be judged according to their faith in the world hereafter, the Yom al-Qiyam. If I die now, am I going to live on in the grave till the day of judgment? Or will I be taken to heaven or live in paradise? I want to know what will happen from now to that day. Yeah.
Okay. On this subject I have spoken at length so many times that even a book can be prepared on this one single subject, collecting all these answers, but there would be repetitions, of course, in different angles also, in every answer. In short, because the time is already run out, I'll try to give you the salient features of this phenomenon, of people dying and then coming to a form of life again. I'll give you a summary of our beliefs. It's not time for me to build all the arguments on which those beliefs are based. When we die, we will not lose consciousness in the sense of the soul which separates from our body. The soul, which is an enigma for the scientists here, is something which, when it parts from the body chemistry immediately begins to decay and return to its constituent substances. And there is no more sense left in the body at all. Does the soul also destroy? Is it so dependent on the body that it must live in a constant bodies with the body or not? According to Islam, in case of other animals, this is right, that when the body dies, the soul, their life dies. When the life dies, not the soul, soul is only mentioned in case of human beings, not in relation to the animals. When the life dies out, the body dies, life dies, it's one and the same thing. But in case of human beings, the word soul is used, ruh. And this has developed to a degree that it has the capability of becoming an independent entity in itself, a spiritual form which can live after separation. What is the nature of that form, we don't know much. But this much at least scientists have discovered, that energy bundles can survive as energy bundles, and previously, before this discovery, they used to poo-poo the idea of believing in souls, but they now admit that what we have discovered leads us to the possibility of some sort of human energy living in an organized form as separated from the physical existence of man. So that is what will happen in the first place. It will have a consciousness of some sort. In the first appearance before God, it will be adjudged briefly, and it would know from then on in which direction it is going to develop. Further development of the soul would require eons of time, a very long period, in which it will develop in the form that a body will be created from within that soul, and a soul will be created from within that body. That is to say, a separation will be made in that existence, so that a center of thinking, a center of entity will be created around the soul, that part of soul which in comparison which appeared to be material, but it will not be material. So it is only a matter of degrees. God is the ultimate of spiritual refinement. So all those who happen to be at a subsequent smaller level or a cruder level, they cannot conceive exactly the nature of the the spiritual nature of God, which defies form, but it does exist and is proved through his works. That existence is proved through the works of God. Beyond that we cannot reach. But about the soul, we have some experience here which can lead us to believe in a phenomenon which may occur after our death. And that is experienced in two ways. Number one, in dreams. In dreams, things happen which appear to be real, but they defy the natural laws of our daily experience. We can walk through walls, we can see things of the past, we can experience visiting countries which we had never visited, and yet feel during the dream as if everything was real. We can meet our dead dear ones of the past and enjoy meeting them and talking to them. And as you are dreaming, you really believe that this is exactly what is happening. But it is not happening in the physical form. Nothing is created. Yet something like that will happen to the soul. But this happening would be more real than our dreams. So the soul will have the same qualities, not exactly, but similar qualities, as that of our new identity within our dreams. According to Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salam, the founder of the Ahmadiyya community, in his great historic book, The Teachings of Islam, The Philosophy of the Teachings of Islam, he builds this subject further by reminding us that it will not be just a dream existence. A new creation will be made out of the essence of man's personality, which has got separated at the end, at the time of his death. That essence will be composed of his views, his thoughts, his attitudes, his goodness or his evil, his acts of defiance of the word of God or his obedience to the will of God. All these continuously make, according to Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salam, a personality within us. So a thing is born within us and we make it. We create our hell or our heaven and we don't realize it. But he said, one day some evil person may suddenly be awakened and he would be absolutely exasperated to realize that he has destroyed himself. What he is a rotten thing. And the good people gradually gain the realization of their nobility to a degree that that realization becomes the very reward of the nobility itself. So once awakened, the conscience creates, human conscience creates the hell for the evil people and the heaven for the good people. So Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salam pointed out that this is not in vain, this is not accidental. This does not happen in case of animals. There is no such sense of nobility or evil actions and their consequences among the animal kingdom. God has specifically been evolved to such a degree where this his acts would create a soul in him. And his heaven and health would be born out of his own actions. They will be given a form by the act of God, that is the new creation. And it will take a very long time, ultimately. So when the last call is made before the resurrection, by that time all the human souls would have acquired a new form, a new body, a new spirit within that spiritual body, and they would be able to suffer. They will be able to acquire the faculty of suffering of that nature, which is not physical fire here, It is a different type of fire which sometimes we experience through extreme repentance, sense of shame, etc., or sense of exposure of our crimes. So this is, in short, what is going to happen to us after our death. While we live, we should try to create a healthier soul within us that can only be created if we become true within. Or in the end, let me quote the words of an earlier questioner, if we go for a pure heart. If we achieve a pure heart, such pure hearts will be saved from the hell. And in the words of Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salam, aag hai par aag se wo sab bachaye jayenge jo ke rakhte hain khuda-e-zul ajaib se pyar. Fire it is, no doubt. But all such people will be saved from that fire who have love of God, true love of God in their hearts. So in the final analysis, purity of heart or love of God are one and the same thing. God bless you. Thank you very much. Assalamu alaikum.